Hello friends, welcome to today's episode where we're going to be going through my top 10 strongest Pokemon returning in the Crown Tundra. So with the Crown Tundra dropping in literally 2 weeks' time today, we can start getting hyped up, we can start getting excited, and I thought it was a good time to take a look at some of the Pokemon that will be returning and put together a top 10 strongest Pokemon list. What I personally think, from a VGC point of view, that will be returning with the Crown Tundra. Now, we've got a bunch of Pokemon. I think we've had around 78 officially confirmed that will be returning the Crown Tundra, and from the data mines that we've had previously, there is about 190. 19. So there's still a bunch of Pokemon yet to be officially confirmed. So this list might not be super accurate, and we're not going to know really whether or not a lot of these Pokemon that haven't been confirmed yet are going to be confirmed until the games actually drop, because I doubt we'll get much more information before the 22nd of October on that release day. Now, before we get into the video now, I'm just going to shout out to all of you that are watching that don't want spoilers, because there will be spoilers within this video if you're trying to go into the Crown Tundra without any information, without any spoiler information, anything like that. Do drop out now, because we're going to be talking about Pokemon that have and probably will be coming into the Crown Tundra when it is released. For those of you that are interested, do stick around and we'll get straight into it. So, kicking off with number 10. Now, I'm basing this on how important speed control is in the every competitive format, and with how well we've seen things like Whimsicott and Talonflame, and how important those Pokemon are to a lot of common cores. Now, I probably wouldn't have put this in otherwise, and this will depend on, I guess, if we get a Tailwind Tutor, which we don't know if we're going to be getting yet or not. It makes a lot more Pokemon viable if we do, but if we don't, it makes these sort of Pokemon a little bit more special and a little bit more useful in the format. And number 10 for myself is Tornadus, and I'm going with the incarnate form here. Obviously, we do have access to their Therian forms, and we do have access to their hidden abilities, so you are going to have access to, once again, the very strong and potent Defiant Tornadus. But for this, I'm actually picking the Prankster Tornadus, because it does get access to Tailwind, gets access to Taunt as well, and it now gets access to Weather Ball, a new feature that it has available to it in the Crown Tundra. So it can take advantage of weathers on the field and really disrupt your opponent that way. But it's for that Tailwind, that Prankster Tailwind, that I'm throwing it in here for. It's going to be very strong, especially with the new speed mechanics that we've got in Sword and Shield. It's going to be a very strong threat and support Pokemon going forward. Coming in at number 9 is Heatran. So the Steel and Fire type Pokemon is finally returning. One of my favorite Pokemon, obviously, with that Flash Fire ability, not taking any damage from opposing fire moves. And it does get access to a few new gems in the Crown Tundra. It gets access to Scorching Sands, which is a ground type attack that can burn. It has a 30% burn chance on your opponent, and it also gets access to Burning Jealousy, which we've seen already in the Isle of Armor on a bunch of Pokemon like Torkoal take advantage of that, where if your opponent gets any stat increases throughout a turn and you go after those stat increases with Burning Jealousy, you will burn both targets. So it's great against opposing Dynamax Pokemon that use Max Airstream and things like that. You can really take advantage of those and really slow down physical threats, which is great for Heatran. Obviously, Heatran in general is going to be another Pokemon that takes advantage of that Dynamax ability. It's already got an incredible typing with that Steel and Fire. It's got great defenses already, and with Dynamax, you're going to be able to just increase that even more, maybe even go weakness policy on it and proc that with maybe Aqua Jet or something like that. We can see a lot of fun shenanigans going on with Heatran in the new Series 7 format. So it's definitely a Pokemon I'm looking at and looking forward to using. Coming in at number 8 is Tapu Lele, probably one of my favorite Tapus, and I wish I could have put it a little bit higher, but I couldn't really justify doing that. Now, one of the things that I really love about Tapu Lele in this format, obviously, it gets its Psychic Surge ability to put the psychic terrain down on the field, but it also gets access to Expanding Force, a new tutor move, which is ridiculously strong. We've already seen how powerful things like Hatterene and Ndidi, that combination is there, and I think Tapu Lele just takes the psychic spam core and those teams to the next level. I really do think psychic spam is going to be a very strong core in the series 7 format, and I would expect to see a lot of this. Think about the fast mode with the Tapu Lele, and then you've got the slow mode with the Hatterene and the Ndidi. You've got two Pokemon that can set up the psychic terrain. It's going to be very hard to kind of control your own terrain if you aren't using the psychic terrain as well. Obviously with Follow Me Ndidi as well, it's perfect protection for something like Scarf Lele. And I mentioned Scarf Lele because I feel like the scarf is a really great item on it going forward into series 7 because of that Dynamax ability that you're now going to have access to. You're going to be able to have that flexibility where you're not so hindered by always running the choice scarf. If you doesn't feel like it's favorable at the time, you can just Dynamax and start throwing out max Mindstorms, max Starfalls and things like that, which is really going to help Tapu Lele become a big threat in this format. So Tapu Lele in at number 8, we're going straight in with another Tapu at number 7, which is Tapu Fini. So Tapu Fini always been a very solid choice in previous formats, and again I don't think it's going to be any different going into the series 7 format when the Crown Tundra does drop and those rules do update on the 1st of November. It does get access to a new tutor move in Flip Turn, which is a pretty much a water type U-turn move, so you can pivot out and get Tapu Fini out of harm's way before any threatening attacks come onto it and kind of reposition your board, and that's such an invaluable tool to be able to do that. Also gets access to Draining Kiss now as well, so it does have access to some sort of recovery, which compare nicely with Calm Mind, which we've seen do so well in previous formats. Tapu Fini obviously with that water and fairy typing just very strong. It's just a different variation of Primarina with maybe some better techs and support options there. So it's arguable there will be discussions which one is better, but I probably would always go with Tapu Fini because of that misty terrain that it does have access to, and I think it's going to be a big threat going into the new format. Number 6 is going to be Entei, one of the legendary dog trio, and I'm so happy this is on the list, and the one reason it is here, obviously it's a very strong Pokemon in its own right, but it does have access with that ability patch that we'll be getting in the Crown Tundra to that hidden ability Inner Focus, making it immune to Intimidates, which is so big. Obviously gets Sacred Fire, which is a very strong stab type attack. It has a 50% burn chance as well, and I think Entei with its just general bulk is going to be a very big threat coming into the Crown Tundra, and I feel like it's going to do a lot of good work in the new format as well, especially with that Dynamax ability. It's one of those things, you know, we're looking at all these Pokemon and saying Dynamax ability is going to be very beneficial for this Pokemon, and I definitely feel like that's going to be the case for Entei. You can slap an Assault Vest on it, it's probably going to be very good, and you've even got the option to throw a Weakness Policy on it as well. Again, it's a little bit like the Heatran where you can use moves like Aqua Jet to activate that and see what you can do from there, but Entei got Weather Ball as well, so it's going to be another Pokemon that gets that distribution, take advantage of the weathers, and you can abuse that in your own way, but very nice choice, and I think going to be very strong in the new format, so definitely one to watch out for. Coming in at number 5 will be no surprise to you all, is another Tapu, and it's going to be Tapu Koko. Tapu Koko obviously has dominated previous formats where it's been available, and with the Crown Tundra it is coming along with that. It has been officially confirmed, we have seen it in the trailers, and it does get a bunch of new options, obviously getting Play Rough, but it does finally get that physical fairy type attack that it's been craving for this whole time. A lot of previous formats Koko has been forced to be predominantly a special type attacker, but now it can take advantage of that 115 base attack that it does have rather than the 95 special attack that it's always relied on in the past. Obviously getting access to Rising Voltage now as one of the tutor moves to take advantage of its terrain that it sets. It gets Misty Explosion, which is a very interesting move. It's the fairy type explosion move. It is a tutor move from the Isle of Armor, and with Play Rough they all make up for really nice options for Koko to be a real physical threat, and with that base 130 speed stat, it's going to be very threatening, and faster than the majority of the format as well. So it does get access to obviously that fast vault switch, so it can pivot out, and it's going to be something that you're going to have to prepare for in the new format coming into series 7. Coming in at number 4 is Cortana, one of the ultra beasts coming in here, and one of my favorite ultra beasts in all honesty. And I think for the one fact that Cortana now gets access to grassy glide kind of throws it right up to the top of this list for myself anyway. It's already a very strong Pokemon, already going to take advantage of that Dynamax mechanic, and with beast boost as its ability, it's a very scary prospect, because once that momentum starts building with Cortana, it feels like the snowball that these beasts, the ultra beasts, used to get is just going to be expedited even more with the Dynamax ability, especially boosting stats as well to kind of support it even further in these games. It's going to be incredibly interesting, to say the least, to see how these new ultra beasts are going to perform in a Dynamax environment. So yeah, I'm going to throw Cortana up there, because obviously with the grassy glide, once you're not Dynamax, or if you don't Dynamax, you're going to be able to take advantage of that priority attack, which is crazy, coming off a base 181 attack stat, which is just nuts. And it's very fast with a base 109 speed stat. It is a little frail, but we've seen in the past players throw things like Assault Vest onto it to take advantage of that way. Obviously Focus Sash as well is another option, but the Assault Vest variant seems very scary right now. So why it is coming in number 4 for one of my strongest new Pokemon coming in to the Crown Tundra. Number 3 is going to be Cresselia. Now Cresselia is an old favorite of mine. I've used it since like 2009 in tournaments. It's just an incredible Pokemon, psychic type with the Levitate ability, just one of the most consistent Trick Room setters in the game, or speed control Pokemon in the game, gets access to Icy Wind as well. So there's another mode there that you can go down if you don't want to go down the Trick Room route. Gets access to a lot of really cool tech, skill swap, ally switch, and I should have mentioned that, but gets access to a lot of nice options. You know, it's got Sunny Day, Moonlight for recovery, but it does get access to a few new things coming into the Crown Tundra. One of them is Stored Power. So if you do go for a Calm Mind variant, I mean, the thought of Calm Mind Cresselia with Sword Power and then Dynamax on top of that is a very scary prospect. I look forward to using something like that, but I don't look forward to playing against something like that. It's going to be an extremely scary Pokemon to face, especially if it does Dynamax. And I think that's maybe what sets it apart from a lot of the other Trick Room setters in the format that we've had before Crown Tundra and then with Crown Tundra, is that Cresselia can be quite offensive as well as being a very strong supportive Pokemon. Coming in at number 2 is going to be what everyone's been talking about when Crown Tundra got announced and what Pokemon were coming back, and that is going to be Landorus, either the Incarnate or the Therian form. Now with Incarnate, with the ability patch available now in Crown Tundra, it's going to have access to that Sheer Force ability, which is a very scary prospect, or you're going to have access to the Therian form, which has been probably the more popular variant throughout previous formats with that Intimidate ability. It gets access to, obviously with the Dynamax ability, it gets access to Airstream, it gets access to Max Quake, so it's got a way to boost its special defense, boost speed for you and your partner. It's a very scary Pokemon to think of, especially with the Intimidate support that it brings with it. It gets access to Weather Ball now, which can be taken advantage of probably more with the Incarnate version, because you probably want to go more special on that one than I would probably imagine you'd want to on the Therian version, but you can go special with both. Decent stats on both variants there, and it gets access to Scorching Sands as well, which is another tutor move that it has access to. So throw an Assault Vest on it, max it, and just do lots of damage, and supporting your partner in Pokemon is what it's going to do, and it's going to be a very hard Pokemon to deal with. So do expect to see a lot of it in the new format. And coming in at number 1, rounding off this list, we're going to finish with another Ultra Beast, and it was really hard kind of deciding what my number 1 was. I kind of went between Landorus and Cresselia for what the potential they had there, but I think I kind of wound up with Stack Attacker, and I might be a little bit biased here, but in my opinion, I do feel like Stack Attacker is probably the strongest Pokemon returning that isn't a box legendary or a mythical or anything like that. But I think Stack Attacker is an incredibly strong Pokemon. It's got one of the slowest base speeds, meaning it can take advantage of Trick Room, which it can set up itself, and then it's got access to a new move tutor move in body press, which we all know how good that move is, and off a, what is it, 211 base defense stat is just nuts. So straight off the bat, that is going to be doing a bunch of damage, and you can further increase that with the Dynamax ability as well, with those max steel spikes to increase its defense even further. Like I say, it does, and it has access to Trick Room, so it can set its own speed control. It has access to support options like Wide Guard, gets access to Gyro Ball, it gets access to Rock Slide. It's a very strong, threatening Pokemon, and I mentioned a little bit earlier in this top 10 list how I feel like Psychic Spam or Psy Spam is going to be very strong in this new format, especially with the new options that we've got with Tapu Lele, Ndidi, Hatterene, the new Galarian Articuno being a psychic flying type. And I think the one thing that you can reliably look upon to deal with this core almost by itself is Stack Attacker. It underspeeds Hatterene, doesn't really care about the attacks that it's going to throw out at it, and it's going to be able to deal huge damage out by setting itself up at the same time for when it's not maxed anymore, and then just throw out ridiculously strong body presses to end the game. Obviously going to need to have that speed control and Trick Room in effect to get the most out of it, but there's a lot of options in this format that we've got available to us with Dusclops, Cresselia, Porygon 2. There's a bunch of options that we can take advantage of. The only drawback is it has got that 4x weakness to fighting, but thankfully fighting is normally physical, and with that huge defense that it's got kind of bolstering it, it's not going to be too worried about the fighting type attacks like something like Tyranitar maybe would be. So that is my top 10 list of the strongest Pokemon returning in the Crown Tundra. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope it's been a little bit educational with some of the new options that we've got available coming in the Crown Tundra. There are a lot of things I've left out, but it was very hard deciding this list for myself. And I got a couple of honorable mentions I'd like to throw in just before we end up today. And that one of them is going to be Regi Gigas. I do feel like this is going to be a very interesting Pokemon, and it's hard to say how well it's going to do. And it does depend on having another Pokemon in your team. So already that feels like it's not going to be as strong maybe as a lot of people are expecting, but it's definitely going to be a lot of fun to play. Regi Gigas, crazy stats across the board. It's got like 100 base speed, 110 base defenses across both special and physical, and the only drawback with it is it obviously gets a slow start ability, but you can take that away with the Galarian Weezing and its neutralizing gas ability that will nullify all abilities across the board. So meaning that Regigigas isn't kind of held back by that slow start ability any longer. Can Dynamax is going to enjoy that Dynamax ability, and with 160 base attack, it can start doing some big damage very early on. So definitely a Pokemon I'm going to be interested in keeping an eye on, especially and see how it does in Series 7. I think it's going to be very cool, and probably one of the first times we're going to be able to really see Regigigas do some very good work. Zerkatry is another one that I would just like to make an honorable mention for. It does get access to Rising Voltage now, that new tutor from the Isle of Armor. So we'll be able to take advantage of that as long as you've got the terrain up. You've got things like Tapu Koko to help with that though, but Zerkatry, definitely a Pokemon I feel has access to Energy Ball and a lot of other things. Obviously Hidden Power is something that it doesn't get access to anymore, but I'm sure it'll be able to kind of find ways around that. And I think Zerkatry in general needs specific support options around it to really function as well as you kind of want it to and be as effective as possible. And I think it does have the tools probably with the Crown Tundra introduction to be able to do that with the rest of the Pokedex. So I'd imagine we'll see a few Zerkatry teams pop up, and it's definitely something not to underestimate if you do see it in team preview. But they're going to be my two kind of honorable mentions here. I hope you've enjoyed today's episode where we've kind of discussed some of the new Pokemon returning and what I personally think are going to be the top 10 strongest Pokemon returning in the Crown Tundra. We will be continuing our Crown Tundra coverage as we are now in the run-up to that dropping on the 22nd of October. Very exciting times. If you have enjoyed today's video, please remember to drop a like. Do subscribe to the channel if you are new, and remember to leave a comment down below. Let me know what your number one strongest Pokemon you think will be returning in the Crown Tundra. I'd love to hear what your thoughts are on this and the selections that we've made in today's video, but I hope you've enjoyed it. Take care of yourselves. Have a great rest of your day. Make sure you're kind to each other. Make sure you're kind to yourselves. And I'll see you all for the next one. So until then, friends, take care and bye-bye.